Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. So a few months ago, I posted a video on my channel, which I'll link to here, in which I talk about this little guy, a 3D printed motorized off-axis gator focuser that I designed and built. So today I am going to share a few exciting updates about this project, and I'm also going to show you how to calibrate this device. So let's get started. I call this device an off-axis gator focuser because that is what I originally designed it for. But I wanted one thing to be very clear. This device can be used as a standalone focuser for pretty much any helical focuser, such as the popular ZWO or SV Boney focusers. For example, I could use it to focus the imaging camera on my spectrograph. If you have a helical focuser, whether it is on your main imaging train or on a guide scope, or if you have some other accessory that you wish to be able to focus accurately without introducing any vibration or remotely, you can use this device. It can also be great for visual observing. And if you use it with the ZWO focuser, you won't have to make any changes and you can just print the STL files that I included in the project's GitHub repository. If you use it with another helical focuser that may have slightly different dimensions, like SV Boney's for example, you'll have to tweak the 3D model ever so slightly so that it fits the focuser correctly. Now, of course, the main use case for this device is still to deal with an off-axis gator, or OAG for short. There are other devices on the market that are designed to allow you to remotely focus a guide camera attached to an OAG. But the software that I wrote, and that you can download from the project's GitHub repository, which deals with filter offsets when switching filters, is really the piece of the puzzle that was missing up until now. And like I mentioned in the original video, the same software could technically be used with a Pegasus Astro Scops OAG, which is a fantastic unit, although it's a little bit expensive at $600. While this DIY focuser costs well under $50 to make. Now, one thing I do not like about my design is that it requires two cables, a 12-volt DC cable to power the stepper motor and a USB Type-C cable to power the microcontroller and to allow the computer to send commands to the device. In general, I have way too many cables on my rig. Here is what I like to think my telescope cabling looks like. And here is what my telescope cabling really looks like. So this year, I would like to create a version 2 of this project and remove the need for both of these cables. After all, we live in the 21st century. So the idea is to use a small lithium polymer battery, like this one, the kind that you would find in small remote controlled airplanes or drones. You would be able to recharge the battery by simply connecting the device to a power supply via a USB Type-C cable during the day. The battery, which weighs almost nothing, would power both the microcontroller and the stepper motor, and it would have enough juice to power the device for many nights. And to send commands to the microcontroller from the computer, the idea is to use Bluetooth Low Energy, or BLE for short, which is a technology that I've been playing with while working on another project, and it works really, really well. So if I do create a V2 of this project, I will definitely publish a video update on the channel. I'm even thinking of doing the same on my DIY flat panel and my automated telescope cover, and basically get rid of all those damn cables. So stay tuned, and don't forget to subscribe to the channel if you don't want to miss future videos. Anyway, I've been using this little device for several months now on multiple astrophotography projects, and it has performed absolutely flawlessly. The only thing that you need to know is that in order for this device to work, not only does it have to be built correctly, of course, but it also has to be calibrated accurately. And you'll see that calibrating this device is not super difficult.
Yes, there's math, but it's really not that hard.
There are basically four steps involved in the calibration of this device. Let's start with step one, which involves measuring your filter offsets. The first step is to measure your filter offsets, which tell the acquisition software, like Nina for example, how many steps and in which direction to move the focuser upon switching filters in order to stay in focus. This is something that you have to do regardless of whether or not you are using this device. I am not going to cover this part in great detail today, but I might eventually publish a video on the topic because it is absolutely critical to the success of your imaging. So, in this video, I will make the assumption that you already know your filter offsets. As an example, here are mine, which I provided to Nina in the autofocus options UI. The second step is to measure the backlash of the focuser. There are many sources of backlash in this system. The stepper motor itself, due to its internal gearbox, already has some amount of backlash. The 3D printed gear and pinion also have some backlash. And finally, the helical focuser has some amount of backlash as well. All of the sources combine. Thankfully, compensating for backlash is relatively easy, and it is supported by the software that I created. The trick is to first measure the amount of backlash in your device, and here is how I do it. You will need a dial gauge indicator, like this one, to measure the minute movements of the focuser. You can pick one of these up on Amazon for under $20, and these can be useful for many other purposes unrelated to astrophotography. I use mine to tweak my woodworking machines, like my table saw or my bandsaw, for example. And my dial gauge indicator is in imperial units, but for our application today, a dial gauge that is digital with the option to use the metric system would make the whole process a little bit simpler. You will need to clamp the focuser and the dial gauge indicator securely to a stable surface. Here I use my workbench. Make sure that the dial gauge indicator is in contact with the focuser. Also make sure that the focuser is roughly in the middle of its range, and if needed, rotate the focuser body by hand before powering the device. Then power the device and start the standalone focuser control application that you can download from the GitHub repository. Click on the connect button. Once connected, move a few hundred steps outward to clear the backlash. You should see the dial gauge indicator moving. The next step is to measure how much distance the focuser moves for every step. To do this, move the focuser outward by a good amount, more than the expected value of the backlash. 500 steps, for example, and using the dial gauge, measure how much it moved. In my case, it moved from position 70 on the dial gauge to 97, so 27 ticks, or a 27th of an inch. Divide that by 500. In my case, I get 27 divided by 500, which is 0.054 tick per step. Then move the focuser inward by the same amount, so 500 steps. In my case, I went from position 97 on the dial gauge to 73.5. But we were expecting to go back to position 70, since that is where we started. The difference is the backlash, which is then 3.5 ticks on the dial gauge. And since a step equals 0.054 tick, 3.5 divided by 0.054 is about 65 steps of backlash. If you want, you can do the same measurement in the other direction, and the value that you obtain should be very similar. When we provide the backlash value in the very last step, since the device uses the overshoot method for backlash compensation, we'll use a value larger than the one we just measured, which also means that the measurement does not have to be extremely accurate. I ended up using a value of 150, and it works well. The third step is to set the zero position. To do this, make sure that the device is not powered and manually rotate the focuser body slowly until you hit the mechanical stop. And the focuser indicator, which may be hidden as in my case, shows that the focuser is at its zero position, meaning that it's all the way in. Then power the device, start the standalone focuser control application, connect to the device, and click on the Set Zero Position button. This sets the position to zero and writes it to the device EEPROM. Once you've done that, you can also refine the maximum position in the device settings dialog. Simply move the focuser by large steps using the standalone focuser control application until the focuser body shows that it's near its limit. Make sure that you do not hit the limit, because if you do, you will have to set the zero position all over again. Then look at the position indicated in the focuser control application and set that in the device settings dialog. The default value of 4000 should work well out of the box for the ZW helical focuser and the 24 or 28 BYJ48 stepper motor, but it doesn't hurt to check it. The fourth and final step is to measure what I call the steps ratio. That number allows the filter wheel proxy ASCOM driver to answer the following question. Upon changing filters, if the main imaging train focuser has to move X steps in one direction, how many steps does the OAG focuser need to move and in which direction in order to compensate? So for example, if the steps ratio is -2, and upon switching filters, the main imaging train focuser needs to move 100 steps outward, then the OAG focuser has to move 100 times -2, so 200 steps inward in order to compensate for the change in focus, which kind of makes sense, I hope. The best way to measure the steps ratio is to use two instances of Nina. The first instance is connected to the telescope focuser and the main imaging camera, which is your standard setup. Run autofocus. Once we're in perfect focus, start a second instance of Nina and connect it to the guide camera and to the OAG focuser. Ensure that this second instance of Nina uses the overshoot focuser backlash compensation method and set the backlash to a value slightly larger than the one we measured in step 2. Review all the other settings as well, because you may need to play with them in order to get a good autofocus curve. Then go to the imaging tab and take an image to see what you get. At that point, if your stars are completely out of focus, you may want to move the focuser manually using the focuser control UI in Nina so that you get a reasonably focused image. Then you can start your autofocus in that second instance of Nina, the one controlling your guide camera and your OAG focuser. One last thing, if you run into some problems during the autofocus routine, check your star detection options. I set noise level to high and pixel scale to long focal length for the best results. Also, I strongly recommend you use the Hocus Focus plugin, which greatly improves star detection and autofocus in Nina. Once this is done, write on a piece of paper the focus point of both the main telescope focuser and the OAG focuser. I got 14,354 and 2,218 respectively. Unfortunately, the screen recording stopped halfway through the procedure, and when I realized that, I was a little too lazy to do it again. But in principle, the idea is relatively simple. Remember, at this point, both cameras are in perfect focus. So the idea is to use the first instance of Nina to move the main telescope focuser by some amount, roughly 3 to 5 times the largest filter offset. So in my case, I would move the main telescope focuser by 500 steps. The direction does not really matter. Let's assume that I move the main telescope focuser outward by 500 steps. That puts me at 14,354 plus 500 equals 14,854. Okay, now go to the second instance of Nina, the one controlling your guide camera and your OAG focuser, and from the imaging tab, manually move the OAG focuser using the focuser UI control buttons and take a short exposure image. The goal is to get to rough focus. Once you've reached rough focus, do an autofocus run in that same instance of Nina and note the final position. In my case, I got 898 steps, which means that we had to move by 1,320 steps inward. All right, so now we have some simple math to do. So we moved the main telescope focuser by 500 steps outward, and to compensate for that, we had to move the OAG focuser by 1,320 steps inward. So we simply divide 1,320 steps by 500 and we get 2.64. We have to remember to put a negative sign in front of it since the two focusers moved in opposite directions. And that's it, we're done. The next step is to test all of this. Let me show you how. Now we can finally configure our filter wheel proxy ASCOM driver. Go to the Equipment tab, then to the Filter Wheel tab, select the filter wheel device named Dark Sky Geek's Filter Wheel Proxy for OAG Focuser, open the device settings dialog and fill out all the required fields. The real filter wheel device, the filter offsets, make sure those are the same as those in Nina, the OAG Focuser device name, the backlash compensation overshoot steps, and finally the steps ratio that we just measured in step 4. Then click OK and connect to the device. The easiest way to check whether your setup works is by autofocusing your main imaging camera, then watch the image coming out of the guide camera either in a second instance of Nina or simply in PhD2 guiding, and then switch to another filter. The image from the guide camera may become out of focus for a quick second, but then should become sharp again, as you can see here. If that is what you see, it means that you have succeeded in calibrating your OAG focuser. That's all I've got for you today. I know that this device is not for everybody and it's a little bit complicated to set up, but it's doable.
I swear it's not that hard.
And it has allowed me to run very complex sequences completely automatically, whereas before I had to get up in the middle of the night to pause the sequence and refocus the guide camera after changing filters. All right, I hope that you found this video helpful. If you have a question, please leave it in the comment section below. Also, please click like, don't forget to subscribe to the channel, and we will be back in a few weeks with another video. Until next time, thank you for watching.